the damage that was sustained to my lungs by COVID pneumonia was what led to the diagnosis of fibrosis. My life before I got COVID, I was a busy mom at home, consummate volunteer at school, and we're an outdoorsy family, so biking, hiking, walking, swimming, all those things. I've had all the vaccinations. In January of 2022, I got a really bad flu cold and my temperature was really high. I ended up speaking to a nurse on the nurse line. She asked me to try going upstairs and I really couldn't. And she said, I think it's time for you to go into the hospital. I went into hospital and things got steadily worse and I ended up in the ICU on a ventilator, not once but twice.
Pulmonary fibrosis after COVID usually happens in individuals who have had quite severe disease and quite severe infection. The more inflammation that there is in the lung during that initial infection, the more risk there is, the reaction to it will be to produce some scarring. The pulmonary fibrosis that we think about is a heterogeneous group of diseases that cause scarring in the lung that gets worse over time, and it really progresses to the point where people might need oxygen, people might need a lung transplant, or people might even pass away because of that disease. COVID and after any severe infection in the lung has a chance of leaving behind a mark, so to say. And as the lung tries to heal from the inflammation of a pneumonia or an infection like COVID, it can lay down some scar tissue and in a sense create pulmonary fibrosis, create scarring. It's a little bit different from all of the other subtypes of pulmonary fibrosis. After COVID, usually things stay either stable or get a little bit better over time, as opposed to being this progressive type of scarring that gets worse and worse and leads to respiratory failure.
I came home on the maximum allowed, which is 6 liters of oxygen. I needed just to walk around, just to get from the bed to the couch kind of thing. In about 3 months' time, I started walking small amounts. Fortunately, I went in fairly physically fit, so that part started to come back. And so I gained more strength, and as the strength came, my willingness to try and use my lungs walking, I just kept trying. I've probably not been using oxygen during the day for the last 6 months. So having equipment at home, having the right equipment, accessing supplies, going for the regular tests to see how things are going, these are all things that consume me. I hope that my lungs continue to get stronger. I hope that any future COVID experiences don't affect me the way that one did. It's so scary. I mean, it's scary for me. It's scary for my children to see. When you've been through near-death experience, we're all just so grateful for what we have. I think it's definitely brought us closer as a family. My kids are teenagers, but they stay tight-knit. And maybe that's a happy outcome. You know, it's like anything else. Keep moving, keep talking, keep asking, reaching out, finding out other people in the same circumstances. Really, really, really helpful in it. Puts your mind at ease.
Classically for interstitial lung disease or for pulmonary fibrosis, what we might hear when we listen to the lungs would be almost like a staticky kind of crackly sound when people breathe in. That is a very simple and non-invasive kind of screening test that you can do to see if there is anything like that going on. But at the end of the day, and the most important point is that if you're not sure about whether there's any kind of residual scarring or anything like that left, or even perhaps more severe scarring that's left over, the only way really to know is with a CT scan.